It was about a year ago today, and I was leaving on a wilderness backpacking trip with some young men from here at Calvary. We were going up to North Manitou Island for a couple of night backpacking and camping trip. And just take a quick straw poll as we get started. How many here love to go camping or backpacking? Any? Okay, a few. And how many love to do anything but go backpacking or camping? Yeah. So I'm kind of more in the first camp. I did a fair amount of camping and that sort of thing growing up. My wife, though, is on the other side. She hates bugs and dirt and all of it that's related to that, so she therefore hates camping, etc. And so we had been preparing for this trip for a while, me going with these younger guys, and so my wife was kind of joking with me in the process leading up to it. She kept saying that she was hoping that I have a great time, but not so great a time that I'd ever want to go camping again. So she was hoping for that, and in fact, she was joking, she was praying for that as well. And lo and behold, her hopes and her prayers were answered. I ended up going on this camping trip with some guys, and like I said, it was a couple night trip, and we went up to North Manitou Island, which for those familiar with it or not familiar with it, it's up kind of northwest part of lower Michigan. And you have to take a ferry across, and then it's a pretty good-sized island. And we went, arrived on the island, and we were met on the island with a park ranger who basically gave us an orientation to the island. And he started orientation basically by giving us all the perils of the island, the animals to look out for, especially the plants to look out for, poison ivy and sumac, etc. And you can kind of probably see where the story's going. He gave us the warning, and as you can imagine, us macho men were thinking, we don't need this warning, we're good. And so we took off on our hike, kind of disregarding the orientation that Mr. Park Ranger had given us. As you can imagine, not very wisely did so. And a couple hours into our trip, we lost the trail, and we ended up at a base of a swamp. It wasn't a very deep swamp, it was a fairly shallow swamp, there were trees down, and so we're thinking, you know what, we could probably like kind of teeter our way over these trees, making our way across the swamp. Our map said there was a trail on the other side of the swamp, so you know what, it's close, we probably can make it. Now if you're wise, you're probably thinking, oh, let's double back and try to find the trail, but that wasn't necessarily us that morning. So we decided to forge through the swamp, and lo and behold, we find the world's biggest forest of poison ivy as we do so. But we didn't know that it was poison ivy in the moment. We didn't know until we got back and discovered poison ivy all over our bodies. I actually ended up getting it the worst. The other guys got it, but they didn't get it as bad as me. The day we got back, I had a rash on my arm and a rash on my face, and I didn't really think it was that big a deal. I was like, maybe I'll just sleep it off. Woke up the next day, it was literally all over my body. It was everywhere. And again, thinking very wisely, like, I'll just sleep it off. It'll go away. My wife is urging me at this point, you should go to the doctors and have this looked at. And I was like, no, I'll be fine. I'm not kidding you. I woke up the next morning, my eyes were sealing shut. It was that bad. My face had ballooned, and I could hardly see out of my eyes. And again, I was thinking, you know what, I think I'll be okay. My wife is still urging me, prompting me, you should go to the hospital, have this checked out. And I had a breakfast appointment that morning, and I was like, you know, I think I'll just still just try, see if I can do this. And I went to breakfast, and kid you not, halfway through the breakfast, name should not be mentioned, I had breakfast with this guy, and halfway through, I kid you not, he leans over and he goes, I just need to ask, is your face like on fire right now? And it's like, actually, yeah, my face is excruciatingly painful right now. So I finally decided to go to the hospital. I got a shot, a cream, and a prescription. And it still lasted over 2 weeks after I received all of that. And so it was absolutely miserable getting poison ivy like that. I'm not sure if any of you had poison ivy like that, but it was horrendous. And I can think back on it now and kind of laugh, like, ha-ha, that's funny. But there was no ha-has in the middle of those 2 weeks. It was absolutely horrible. And I remember being in the midst of that. I couldn't think. I couldn't function. And literally, there were many nights I couldn't sleep. It was so painful. It seemed so weighing. It seemed so unrelenting and unending. It was this great burden, and it felt like I just couldn't function. I couldn't go through life because it was all that was on my mind. I couldn't think. I couldn't function. And many nights, I literally could not sleep. So the question I have for you this morning is, have you ever had a burden in life where you can't think, you can't function, and literally sometimes you can't even sleep? the weight of it feels so unending and unrelenting that you feel like you just can't function. And have you ever have a burden like that before? I think burdens come in a lot of different forms, and they come in variety as to severity. They can be a physical burden or a bondage, something like poison ivy, but something especially worse than that. We have a lot of families in our church family that are struggling right now through physical ailments, cancer, etc. And those are burdens, and in the midst of those, it may be hard to think or to function or sleep at night. Maybe that's you this morning, some sort of physical ailment or burden. But there's also social burdens as well, relational burdens. Maybe it's a broken relationship that's weighing you down. It's heavy on your mind. It's constantly reminding you. Or it's a grief of a loss of a loved one, and the loss of that person is constantly before you. You can't seem to think or function or sleep that night. Or maybe it's a spiritual burden where it's a struggle that you've been fighting, it seems like, forever, and it seems like there's no end in sight. Regardless of what it is, my suspicion is most of us in this room, if we're honest with ourselves, enter into this morning with some form of burden, physical or spiritual or social, whatever the case may be. And I think if we're even willing to admit, many of us in here would say that our burden is actually a bondage. It feels so heavy upon us that I can't think, I can't function, and many nights I can't even sleep. Maybe that's you this morning. I suspect if we're honest, many of us would say that's us this morning. I have a burden that feels so heavy, so unrelenting, and so unending. And so the big question I have for you then this morning is, in the midst of your burden or in the midst of your bondage, where do you go? In the midst of your burden, in the midst of your bondage, where do you go? Specifically, who do you go to, or what do you go to? I think in the midst of our burdens, in the midst of our bondages, we can go to a lot of different places, we can go to a lot of different people, we can go to a lot of different things. The question is, in the midst of your burden, in the midst of your bondage, where do you go? So this morning, I want to look at a story involving a man who had a great burden. He had a great bondage. And I think the solution that this man sought and the solution this man found should be greatly insightful for us this morning, regardless of our burden, regardless of our bondage. So if you have a Bible, please open up with me to Mark chapter 1. Mark chapter 1 is where we're going to be this morning. We're going to be in verses 40 through 45. Before we dive in, I think it's important to note a couple things from the context. Mark begins his gospel account in verse 1, basically providing a thesis statement or a main idea. In Mark 1:1, it says, the beginning of the good news about Jesus the Messiah, the Son of God. And you could say this is kind of the big idea of the entire book. And so Mark just kind of lays it right out there from the very beginning. Some translations say Jesus Christ. And I think it's helpful, the NIV here says Jesus the Messiah. I think that's helpful because oftentimes when we hear Jesus Christ, we think of Christ as his last name. But Christ was actually a title. Jesus was the Christ. He is the Christ. He is the Messiah, the Savior, the anointed one who came to make things right. And so Mark begins his gospel account by proclaiming that from the very beginning, that this Jesus is the one, the Savior, who came to make things right. And he is the divine one, the Son of God. And so the book begins with this kind of main idea, this purpose statement from the very beginning. So I think it's helpful to keep that in mind because this passage as well will illuminate that reality as well. But also in Mark 1:15, Jesus gives us his main purpose statement of his ministry, the main proclamation. Mark 1:15, it says, the time has come, the kingdom of God has come near, repent and believe the good news. This message about the reign of God, the kingdom of God being at hand, was at the center of Christ's ministry. He was constantly proclaiming this message that the reign of God, the kingdom of God, it's present, it's here, it's among us. As Christians, we believe that the kingdom of God is yet to come, meaning that this life is not all that there is. We believe that heaven is a reality that we have to look forward to, and that God is actually going to bring heaven upon the earth, and he's going to restore the earth, and we have to look forward to the new earth where we actually get to dwell with God forever. But Jesus came with this message indicating that that future reality is actually also a present reality. The reign of God is present, it's here, and the life that is to come, you can actually taste in the here and now. It may be a partial taste, but nonetheless, it's a real and genuine taste. And then Jesus went out from there, and he started healing people. He rose the dead to life, and he healed sickness and the like, and cast out demons. And all of that was a demonstration of this message, that the kingdom of God actually is at hand. And so that's already occurred here in Mark 1. I think it's helpful to think, consider that, because this message about the kingdom of God being at hand, I think, is verified by the passage we're going to look at this morning. But nonetheless, we're going to be in Mark chapter 1, verses 40 through 45. To help you, the bulletin has an outline. You don't need to use that if you don't want to, but I think the three scenes or the three movements of the story are helpful. First, we're going to see the submission of a man in a great burden. Then we'll see the submission provided to him, or the solution provided to him, and then after that, the surprise following the solution. And so if you get lost along the ways, I believe those are kind of the three movements or the three scenes, if you will, of the story. So we're going to take this one scene at a time and kind of progress the story somewhat slowly. So let's start in Mark chapter 1, verse 40, looking at the submission. It begins by saying, a man with leprosy came to him and begged him on his knees, "If you are willing, you can make me clean." Now, I think it's important to note from the context that leading up to the story, Jesus had gone out on preaching campaigns in Galilee around this area. And so he was out proclaiming the good news, and as he's doing so, this man runs up to him and surrenders at his feet. Now, think about this, if you will. The story in Mark indicates that Jesus had been healing many people. And so he had cast out demons, he healed the sick and the like, and it's very likely that this man kind of heard the murmuring, that there's a miracle worker, potentially the Messiah, the Savior, roaming about preaching and healing people. And this man thinks to himself that he could potentially find deliverance in this Christ. Think about this. This man was desperate, and he was looking for deliverance, and he goes running to Christ as a result. But the story identifies this man not by name. That's not the focus of the story. He's not specifically identified. What's identified is his leprosy. It says a man with leprosy came to him. Leprosy is actually the focus of this story. If you read back in the Old Testament, we don't have to turn there now, but Leviticus 13, Leviticus 14 kind of gives you some prescriptions as to those who had leprosy. It was not a fun disease to catch. It was not a fun condition to have. It led to isolation for those that had it. In the Old Testament, leprosy, you could say, was kind of a catch term, a bucket term that kind of categorized many different skin diseases. So it was a different form of defiling skin disease, essentially, was what the term leprosy represents here. But the consequence of having leprosy is outlined in these verses in Leviticus 13, 45, and 46. It says, anyone with such a defiling disease must wear torn clothes, let their hair be unkept, cover the lower part of their face, and cry out, unclean, unclean. As long as they have the disease, they remain unclean. They must live alone. They must live outside the camp. Sounds like a horrible existence, does it not? Think of this. This man is in great burden. He's in a great bondage. And the first century Josephus actually helps us as well. He adds a little bit of comment on this in terms of what it was like for these people. He says, speaking of the law of Moses, for those who had leprosy, he forbade those that had leprosy either to continue in a city or to inhabit a village, but commanded that they should go about by themselves with their clothes rent, declares that such as either touch them or live under the same roof with them should be esteemed unclean. And so, thinking of your own burden this morning, it could come in a lot of different forms, physical, social, or spiritual. But think of this man, his burden, his bondage. He obviously had a great physical burden. Leprosy was a loathed existence, oftentimes even leading to death. So it was a great physical weight, a burden, a bondage. But it was also a social burden and bondage. This weight that this man was facing led to his isolation. He could no longer live among the community. He had to live in isolation away from the camp. But also that's a spiritual bondage, because at this time it was believed that the presence of God dwelt among the camp. And so this man would have presumably believed or thought that he was also separated from the presence of God, a physical burden, a social burden, a spiritual burden. This man had it all. And in the midst of his desperation, he runs to Jesus for deliverance. The question I have for us this morning is, in the midst of our burdens, in the midst of our bondages, where do we go? What do you run to? Or who do you run to? I think as we consider our lives, it's very easy for us to run to many false gods in the midst of our burdens, in the midst of our bondages. I have, many of you know this, we have a young son. Our son is almost 2 years old now, which is crazy to think about, but our son is a cute little guy, and he's learning vocabulary, and he now says please, but he can't say his L's quite right, so he says peace, peace, and he oftentimes will look out from our house, the slider, and he'll see a dog across in the other neighbor's yard, and he'll see the dog, and he wants to be held by the dog, but the dog can't see him, and the dog obviously can't hold him, so he'll throw his arms out like this, and go, peace, peace, and he'll do that with his book as well. If you're reading a book and he wants to be held by the book or something in the book, he'll hold his arms out, peace, peace, and it's super cute, but then you have to see it for a while, like, buddy, that's kind of ridiculous, like the book can't hold you, the dog's not going to hold you, but then it kind of hit me, you know what, a picture of us in the midst of our burdens. We look to something that can't hold us, we look to something that can't sustain us, to ultimately satisfy us, and it's going to leave us broken and longing. I was reading a study recently that right now the average American spends over 5 hours a day watching television. The average American spends over 5 hours a day watching. Imagine if you also added screen time with cell phones and computers to that number, what the average would actually be. But the average American spends over 5 hours a day watching television. And think about this. It's possible that in the midst of our burdens, in the midst of our bondages, we try to check out before a screen. If I just numb myself before the screen, I'll feel better. But if you've been there before and you do that, what's often the result? You feel worse after you numb yourself in front of a screen. It doesn't bring the fulfillment, it doesn't bring the satisfaction that you maybe thought it would. Or maybe we go to the fridge or the cupboard for food, thinking that food ultimately will satisfy us. We try to satisfy our stomachs when our souls are starving, and it ultimately leaves us longing. We may look to our work to satisfy us. We may try to make a name through our vocation, and try to make a name for ourselves through accomplishments and achievements, but ultimately it leaves us longing. For God has already given us a name in Christ. And our life, our identity is not found in trying to make a name for ourselves, but understanding who we are in Christ. But there are a lot of different broken ways that we try to respond to our burdens and respond to our bondages. So the question I have then is, in the midst of your burden, in the midst of your bondage, where do you go? Who do you go to? What do you go to? This man, in the midst of his desperation, he sought deliverance in Christ, and I think he gives us an example to follow. I think this man believed, at least at a basic level, that Christ is the one who sets captives free. He believed it, and he ran to Christ, and he surrendered himself there. And I believe if we truly expect to find wholeness in the midst of our hurt and the hardships of life, then we need to run to the true healer, who is Christ himself. Christ is the one who sets us free. Christ is the one who gives us wholeness. Christ is the one who makes us new. So in the midst of your burden, in the midst of your bondage, run to him. Run to him. Run to him. He is worthy of our surrender. He is worthy of our submission. The theologian Augustine once said that our hearts are restless until they find their rest in thee, until they find their rest in God. Run to him. Run to him. Run to him. He is worthy of your surrender. He is worthy of your submission. He is worthy of your all and everything. But nonetheless, this man runs to Jesus, and he finds the solution to his problem. Let's look going on in verses 41 through 42. It says, Jesus was indignant. He reached out his hand and touched the man. Now, the term indignant is translated in other translations as filled with compassion or pity. You might have that in your Bible before you. Some it says it's angered or has indignation. And the reason for that is that that translation is based off two different manuscripts, some off a term that means anger, some off a term that means compassion or pity. And that may seem like a glaring contradiction, but I think as we consider the story, either of those terms actually can make good sense of the context, if you really think about it. Jesus was indignant. He was angry. And I think that Christ was angry at sin and its consequences. He looks at this man in great bondage, in great desperation. This is not the way it was supposed to be. God had different intentions for this world. And I believe Christ was angry, indignant in the midst of that. But Christ also sees this man who runs after him looking for deliverance in the midst of his desperation. And Christ is filled with compassion for this man. Compassion for the man himself in the midst of his desperation. The term moved with compassion or pity typically is used in the scriptures to convey having or requesting pity or compassion for others. For instance, the father in the story of the prodigal son was filled with compassion or pity for his son when he runs after him. And the significance of this term is that it was connected with the coming of the Messiah. So the Savior was the one who was expected to have great pity, compassion for people. And so Jesus comes as one with great compassion for people. And so there's an indication, once again, of Christ being the one who came to make things right. But nonetheless, he reaches out and he touches this man with leprosy. Now, as you can imagine, touching a person with leprosy brought severe consequences. Leprosy at this time was quite contagious, and so whether airborne or by touch, not a whole lot is known about leprosy at that time, but nonetheless, it was contagious. That's why people were isolated from the camp. And so in many ways, they were considered the untouchables. They were considered the unreachables. Nobody touched a leper. Nobody went close to a leper. And yet Jesus reaches out his hand and he touched this man. Jesus touches the untouchable. Jesus reaches the unreachable. And so I'm not sure where you're at this morning, but maybe you're here this morning and you've had the suspicion that maybe you're too far gone for the grace of God. Maybe you're too far gone for the forgiveness of sins. And I think in this glorious reality, we have this picture proclaimed that Christ is the one who touches the untouchables and reaches the unreachable. So no matter where you are this morning, no matter what your story is, Christ is the one who can reach you and transform your life. In Christ is newness of life, and he can transform the life of any person. And if you're here this morning and you've thought that about maybe somebody else in your own sphere, I want to challenge you to think about that. That Christ is the one who sets captives free. Christ is the one who can transform the heart of any person. He reaches the unreachable. He touches the untouchable. And so trust that, believe that Christ is sufficient to transform the life of any single person. Jesus demonstrates, though, his ability and willingness to heal this man, not only by touching him, but also what follows. In verse 41, it continues, it says, "I am willing," he said, "be clean." Immediately the leprosy left him, and he was cleansed. It's amazing to think about this. This man who had been in bondage likely for a long time was instantly healed by the command of Christ. Christ spoke, and the leprosy left this man like that. And I think as we read the gospel accounts and we are kind of exposed to these healing accounts of Christ, him healing the sick, raising the dead, etc., but also him healing those with leprosy, it's very easy for us to think that that was normative, like people were healed of leprosy all the time. But that's actually not the case. In fact, when John the Baptist had his disciples ask Jesus, "How do we know that you're the Messiah?" One of the proofs that Jesus provided was that those with leprosy are being healed. This was a big deal, that somebody with this burden, somebody with this bondage was actually set free. And so don't think that this was just everyday, run-of-the-mill sort of occasion. Somebody freed of their leprosy was a big deal. This man was freed from his burden. This man was freed from his bondage. And the compassionate touch of Christ teaches us that the transformative power of the kingdom of God is at hand. He has the power to transform the life of any person. These people with leprosy were considered the untouchables. They were considered the unreachables. And yet Christ Jesus touched this man and transformed the life of this man. But I think this story points to a greater reality beyond physical healing, that Christ is the one who sets captives free. And there's a passage in 2 Corinthians 5:21. It says, "God made him who knew no sin to be sin for us so that in him we might become the righteousness of God." We see this glorious proclamation here that Christ touches this unclean one, and the unclean one becomes clean once again. There's this great exchange, this great transfer. And I think it points to a greater reality, that the Bible proclaims that in Christ we find forgiveness of sins. In Christ we find new life. Christ takes upon himself our sin and gives us his righteousness and perfect standing with the Father. And so if you're here this morning, you've never received Christ as your Savior, if you've never received Christ himself, I would strongly encourage you to do so. In him we find forgiveness of sins. In him we find union with God himself. In him we find a new heart. In him we find a new life. In him we find a new way of life. And in him we find a hope of what is yet to come. So I'd encourage you, if you're here this morning, you've never cried out to him for salvation, today could be that day. Surrender yourself, submit yourself to him, for he is worthy of your life, he is worthy of your submission, he is worthy of your all and all. Christ is the one who sets captives free. I work with teenagers here at Calvary. In the last few years, we've taken a trip to Chicago on a mission trip, and we've had the opportunity to go into the community near where we've served, And we've been able to interact with this woman called Miss Pearl, and she runs, operates this daycare center for single moms and their children. And Miss Pearl has one of those like crazy testimonies, like rap sheet testimony. Like you name it, Miss Pearl had done it. Just kind of one of those wild stories. And oh, just as a side note here, I've noticed just as Christians, when we hear somebody share their rap story, the rap sheet testimony, we can be a little bit jealous of that. Like, I wish I sold drugs at four. if Jesus Christ has saved you, if Jesus Christ has bought you, if Jesus Christ has made you new, that's something to share. That's something to talk about, regardless of what your story includes. But nonetheless, she had one of these crazy stories, these crazy testimonies, and she oftentimes shares, and I ask her if she's willing every time we go down to share it, because it has powerful influence, impact on our students. But nonetheless, by the age of 20, she had multiple children, multiple fathers. She was selling drugs, selling herself, you name it. It was a part of her story. And her kids ended up getting attracted to a church through a bus ministry, and her kids started going to this church. And her kids came back home one Sunday, and they said, "Mommy, Jesus can fix you. Mommy, Jesus can fix you." And so after some time, she finally went to the church. And in the basement of the church, there was a Sunday school teacher proclaiming the gospel. And in the middle of his lesson, he said, "In Jesus Christ, there's forgiveness of sins." And she stood up in the middle of the lesson and pointed at him, and she called him a liar. Said, "You liar." And so he actually, after class, came up and talked to her and tried to explain some things. And she went home that day. She fell on the floor in the kitchen. She cried out to Christ, said, "If you are real, you need to make yourself real in my life." Now, part of her story, Miss Pearl, over years of her life leading up to that point, she said that she would spend hours in the shower scrubbing herself, trying to become clean. In that moment on the kitchen, she cried out for salvation, asking the Lord to cleanse her. Instantly, she felt clean. Christ is the one who sets captives free. Christ is the one who sets captives free. What is your burden? What is your bondage? Run to him. Run to him. Run to him. He is the one who sets captives free. He is the one who sets captives free. Run to him. Run to him. Now, I will say, too, I think there is a little bit of tension in the story as well, because this man, he had a burden. He had a bondage. He was looking for deliverance. He cried out to the Lord, and he received it. He was cleansed. He was made new. He was made whole. But do you wrestle with this tension a little bit? That's great for this man. He received deliverance. Yet I'm in this burden, or he or she is in this burden, and they've earnestly sought the Lord. They've prayed, and yet they have not been delivered from their burden. They've not yet been delivered from their bondage. You ever wrestle with that tension? I pray, he prays, she prays. We've been seeking deliverance for some time now, Lord, and yet it has not come. And I think as we read this story and are made aware of answer to prayer, sometimes it may make us wonder of why we may experience unanswered prayer in our own life. And I'm not in any way going to try to solve that mystery this morning in our short time together, but I do think that there are some answers in Scripture that help us in light of the story. Later on in Mark, for instance, Jesus in chapter 10 proclaims both the realities that God is good, in fact, he's all good, and also he's able to do all things. And so anytime we experience unanswered prayer in life, it's not because God is lacking in goodness or power. So anytime we experience unanswered prayer, don't go there. God is not lacking in anything. God is all good. God is all powerful. Trust him in the midst of the storm, in the midst of the burden. But other passages in Scripture, I think, help us in terms of maybe at times why prayers may go unanswered. 1 Peter 3, for instance, speaks of how our conduct as husbands towards our wife can influence the effectiveness of our prayers. If we treat our spouse poorly, for instance, that can actually be a block in our prayers, the effectiveness of our prayers. James also speaks of how our doubting of God can affect receiving something from the Lord. And he also goes on in chapter 4 to speak of our motives, that the way in which we ask matters in how we pray. But even with some of those things that Scripture highlights in terms of why we may not receive something in prayer, still doesn't, I think, answer or solve the tension or the mystery to unanswered prayer. And I think part of that is that we can be God-fearers, we can be followers of Christ who love the Lord, who ask in line with the will of God with good motives for a good thing, and yet the answer is still no. And I think we actually have an example of that. I think we have multiple examples of that in Scripture, one of which is the Apostle Paul. In his letter to the Corinthians, the Apostle Paul talked about this thorn in the flesh. We don't know what this is or what that was, but it was a burden to him. And he asked the Lord three times, the text says, that the Lord would deliver him from that burden, from that bondage. And I think what the answer he received is quite insightful for us this morning. 2 Corinthians 12:9, but he said to me, "My grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly about my weaknesses, so that Christ's power may rest on me." We may not have the answer as to why some prayers go unanswered, but God is good. God is all-powerful. We should ask in faith, we should pray diligently, but recognize that God is at work in ways greater than we could ever possibly imagine. Revelation 21 paints this glorious picture that God is making a new heaven and a new earth. God is restoring creation, and he is going to have his people dwell with him there forever. And in Christ, I think that reminds us that our greatest problem has been cared for. If you're a Christian, your greatest burden, your greatest problem has been cared for and addressed by God. You then, therefore, should be able to trust him with the rest. You may not have the answer to your other burdens. Trust him in the midst of it and recognize that he is worthy of your submission. He is worthy of your surrender, even if you don't receive the answer you're hoping for in the midst of your burden. Amen? The story goes on, movement three, or scene three, if you will, in verse 43, and we see the surprise following the solution. This man was cleansed of his leprosy instantly. But then Jesus responds with a little bit of surprise with the remainder of the story. We read in verse 43, Jesus sent him away at once with a strong warning. "See that you don't tell this to anyone, but go, show yourself to the priest, and offer the sacrifices that Moses commanded for your cleansing as a testimony to them." Now, it's difficult to even imagine the emotions that were likely streaming through this man's mind. He was likely in bondage to this leprosy for years on end. We don't know. The man's not identified. But it's likely that he had been in this bondage for a long, long time. If you were cleansed of this leprosy, you were set free of your burden, you think your natural thought was, "I probably should keep silent about this." Do you think that would have been your natural reaction? Instead, Jesus tells this man to be quiet about this. We don't really know why Jesus gave him that command. The context of the story may indicate in verse 45. That's because Jesus would then be kind of overwhelmed with massive crowds and would kind of prohibit him from going into certain locations. That's possibly an explanation, but we just don't really know. Nonetheless, Jesus gave this man a clear instruction to be silent. But just think about this from the man's experience. Like, he's been separated from community for some time, likely years, and then he's just supposed to show up, just kind of like, "Oh, no big deal." Like, he shows up the water cooler the next day, and the guy's like, "Hey, Joe, what happened to your spots? Like, what's going on?" They're like, "Nothing, there's no big deal." Like, did you imagine just how hard, how difficult that would have been? Like, try to picture that. It's not a secret, really, that would have been easy to keep. But nonetheless, Jesus gave him a very clear instruction. Don't tell this to anyone, but instead go to Jerusalem. And I think in the midst of that command, I think it should remind us that oftentimes we do what we do because we think what we think. And our feelings, our emotions oftentimes get in the way of our obedience. This man would have had strong emotions to share this, but Christ told him specifically, don't talk about this, instead go to Jerusalem. The strength of our emotions does not minimize the sinfulness of our disobedience. This man was given very clear instructions from Christ. Don't talk about this here. Instead, go to the priests and offer the sacrifices. And so I think we're reminded in the midst of this story that our emotions do not minimize the sinfulness of our disobedience. Instead of talking about this, this man was instructed to go to the priests and offer the sacrifices required. Again, if you want to read this later, it's in Leviticus 14, the requirements for those who were healed of leprosy. There are quite a few different requirements for those. Involve birds and blood and washing of clothes, the shaving of hair, a lot of kind of strange stuff and different sorts of offerings. All of this was a part of those who had been cleansed of leprosy. And honestly, like I said, this was not a common occurrence. So it's not like the priests were doing this sort of offering on a regular basis for those who had been cleansed of leprosy. And so think about this for just a moment. Jesus told this man, don't proclaim this in Galilee where he was, but instead go to Jerusalem and offer the sacrifice that is required in the law of Moses as a testimony to them. To them, that's the priests in Jerusalem. As you think about the gospel stories, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, who's often against Jesus? It's the religious establishment, the Pharisees, the scribes, the priests, etc. As you read through the stories, those are oftentimes the enemies, if you will, of Christ. And before any of that conflict begins in the gospel accounts, we have this advance proclamation from Christ. Go to Jerusalem, offer the sacrifices as a testimony to them of what has just happened. Messiah has come, and he's making people whole. He's making people new. And so I believe you have in the story an advance proclamation of grace to the priests in Jerusalem before any of this conflict with the religious establishment even develops. And this man was given a mission. He was given a mission to proclaim, but not there in Galilee. He was to go to Jerusalem, to the priests, and offer these sacrifices as a testimony to these priests that this Jesus is the Christ, the one who is making all things new. They had a warning and an invitation, these priests, to receive the work of Christ in light of this advanced proclamation. And so many who think that they are in, which would have included these priests and the religious establishment, are actually out and are being extended an invitation, while those who have been out, like this man with leprosy, are being brought in. It's a powerful message of the kingdom of God at work among men. But the story progresses and says, instead, he went out and began to talk freely, spreading the news. As a result, Jesus could no longer enter a town openly, but stayed outside in lonely places, yet the people still came to him from everywhere. So Jesus told the man to be quiet and show himself to the priest. Instead, he preached boldly what Jesus had done and showed himself to anyone he could find. Jesus commanded the leprosy to disappear, and it did without second thought. Jesus told the man to be quiet, and he spoke without hesitation. It should almost be shocking to us how easily we can rationalize and justify our sin. God gives us specific instructions in his word, and whether it's because of our strong emotions or whatever the case may be, we make excuses and we justify or rationalize our sin. And I believe whatever the lame excuse we may provide for our sin, it's still that a lame excuse. As followers of Christ, we should give ourselves to his instruction. As followers of Christ, we should desire to do the will of God. And I think oftentimes, we get a little mixed up in our thinking about obedience to the Word of God. As Christians, we are saved by grace alone, not by works. Amen? It's only by God's grace that we are saved. We cannot make ourselves right with God. But I think oftentimes as Christians, we think because of that, we no longer have no relation to God's instruction. And that's a false understanding of the grace of God. Christ transforms us by his grace. Then he leads us back to his instruction to show us how to live. God's law illuminates our sin and shows us how much we need him as Savior. But as Christ saves us and transforms us, he then leads us back to his instruction to show us how to live. And as his people, we should desire to do his will. And so when Christ speaks in his word, we should give ourselves to his instructions. What is Christ asking of us today? We should be faithful to that instruction. Genuine obedience to God is not legalism. It's an act of gratitude for God's gracious work in our lives. But this story, nonetheless, ends with, once again, a picture of this great exchange. The leper began on the outside, and now Christ is on the outside. He's taken the place, if you will, of the leper, and the leper's been brought back into community. God made him who knew no sin to be sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. Christ takes upon our sin, our burden, so that we could be set free and made whole. What is your burden? What is your bondage? Run to him. Run to him. Run to him. The story ends with news spreading fast and people wanting to see Jesus for themselves. And I believe people are at least beginning to understand at a basic level that this Jesus is the one who sets captives free. Christ sets captives free. We need to believe that reality as Christians. And if you're here this morning, you've never accepted Christ, I encourage you to receive that. Christ is the one who sets captives free. What is your burden? What is your bondage? Run to him this morning. Run to him today. Run to him with your life. So then, what should we take away from this story? I believe, again, the big idea, the big point of this message is that Christ is the one who sets captives free. Freedom is found in him. New life is found in him. Run to him. Run to him. run to. He is worthy of your surrender. He is worthy of your submission. He is worthy of your all and all. No matter your burden, no matter your bondage, run to him. So two key takeaways, applications. Hopefully you've caught these along the way. But this man demonstrated for us an accurate response to trials, an accurate response to burdens, an accurate response to bondage. In the midst of his desperation, he sought deliverance at the feet of Christ. So what's your burden this morning? What's your bondage? Run to him. Run to him. He is worthy of your surrender. He's worthy of your submission. But also we catch a not so healthy example from this man. This man is set free from his burden, and then he disregarded the instruction of the Lord. And so as Christians who've been bought with a price, that's been set free, we should care about the will of God. We should care about the word of God and give ourselves to his instructions out of grateful joy for what he's done in our lives. He is worthy of our surrender and our submission. We should submit ourselves at Christ's feet and surrender, as well as submit ourselves to his instruction in obedience. And so as we go from here this week, I want to remind you of the words of Christ that he gave his disciples as he was leaving them shortly before his betrayal. He said, I quote, "I have told you these things so that in me you may have peace. In this world you will have trouble." Catch that? In this world you will have trouble. This is how Christ left his disciples. In this world you will have trouble. But take heart, I have overcome the world. Christ is the one who sets captives free. Christ is the one who sets captives. In the midst of your burden, in the midst of your bondage, run to him. So, beloved, let us be reminded as we go from here that in this life we will face hardship and difficulty, but let us take heart, for Christ is the one who sets captives free. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this morning. We thank you for your goodness. We thank you that you are the one who restores, you are the one who makes new. You are the one who satisfies us. You are the one who sustains us. You are the one who gives us new life. And you are worthy of our awe. You are worthy of our everything, our devotion, and our surrender. Help us to come to you. Help us to run to you. In the midst of our burden, in the midst of our deliverance, I ask you to help us be faithful to your instruction, recognizing that your way is the way to life. You are worthy, Lord. And I ask that you'd help us to be faithful to you this day, the rest of this week, and the days that follow. We thank you, Lord, for your word, the gift that it is to us, the nourishment that it is to our soul. Help us to live in light of it today. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen.